What's going on, guys? It's Jesse with NAVAC. There is a lot of talk and a lot of conversation about the new refrigerants that are coming out. If you haven't heard, the A2L refrigerant. We're going to address some common thoughts and inquiries that I have come across in my time out in the field. And when I say out in the field, I travel all over the country and I listen to you guys and I hear your concerns. And then I sit down and I do these little rapid fire lists and we go through any kind of myths or debunk anything that isn't true or accurate. So with that being said, let's jump right into it. A2L refrigerants contain propane. They actually don't. In fact, the A2L designation was created just for itself because these refrigerants do not burn like an A2 refrigerant burns, but they do have a higher flame propagation than an A1 refrigerant does. However, this isn't to be confused with an A3 refrigerant. An A3 would be propane or R290. Let me explain a little bit further. If you look on the screen, probably somewhere around here, there'll be a chart that is going to explain ASHRAE Standard 34. ASHRAE Standard 34 is how each refrigerant receives its designation based on toxicity and flammability. The letter in turn represents the toxicity, while the number represents the flammability of that particular refrigerant. As you'll see on the chart, you have A1, A2L, A2, and then A3. A2L earned its own designation by going through the same testing procedures that every single refrigerant that has ever been produced has gone through. So yes, even the A1 refrigerants went through this same testing procedure, and it was determined that they had no flame propagation. So as you can see on the chart, each individual refrigerant earned its own designation. So the common myth that A2Ls actually contain propane is nothing but a myth. There is no propane in an A2L refrigerant. Flammable is flammable. That stuff will explode. Well, not exactly. While yes, an A3 refrigerant, again, such as R290, like we said before, is a very volatile refrigerant and can actually combust and produce an explosion if it comes into contact with the right air mixture, as well as if it comes into contact with open flame. It's a very volatile refrigerant. However, again, looking at that chart that we just went through, the A2 and the A2L are a lower flammability rating. And between the two of them, the A2L actually has the lower flammability rating between the two. And also keep in mind too, that the testing that was performed on all of these refrigerants is in a lab setting, AKA a controlled space. And also, as just a really quick little note for you on that, if you look at the same testing that was actually performed on the A1 refrigerants, you'll find that the A1 actually did produce a flame. It did ignite. But when you look at that testing apparatus, they had a V or a 90 degree angle on the apparatus. And depending on how much of the flame actually expanded outside of that V, that is how they determine these designations. If you look at the A1 test, which we'll picture somewhere here on the screen, probably right here again, you can see that there is indeed a flame there, but it never went outside of the apparatus testing procedure, so therefore it was listed as no flame propagation. However, even though it states that, words are tricky, there's clearly a flame in that test. Long story short on this particular one, flammable is flammable, yes, but here's a fun fact for you. Almost any form of matter, if placed in the right environment, will combust and become a fuel. It still seems pretty dangerous. I'm just not gonna work around that stuff. Fun fact, you already are. In fact, the refrigerant that you are accustomed to, R410A, is 50% R32, which is one of the new low GWP refrigerants that is set to replace R410A. Whether you've been aware of it or not, you've been working around A2Ls this entire time. In addition to that, a fun fact for you is almost every vehicle on the road today is actually charged with an A2L. So you're talking about R1234YF. These vehicles do get into accidents, and we don't ever hear of any form of a catastrophic explosion because of the refrigerant charge in these vehicles. So again, keep in mind, it's not a gasoline or water type deal. Don't overthink it and don't believe everything you read on the internet. So why are we switching anyway? Big brother said so. That's why. No, I'm just kidding. But seriously, if you really want to know why the switch is, it's because back in 2020, Congress implemented the AIM Act. This act would focus on the reduction and substitution of HFC refrigerants, such as R410A. The primary reason for this is while, although HFCs do not deplete the ozone, so they have a zero ozone depleting potential, they have an insanely high global warming potential. Now, wait a second. You said that HFC refrigerants are being phased down. R32 is an HFC refrigerant. You're right. R32 is an HFC refrigerant. However, remember what I said a few seconds ago about a GWP under 700. R32 falls in that category. Its GWP is under 700, so therefore, while R410A is being phased down, R32 is here to stay, and it will be a suitable replacement for R410A systems. So what, we can't install R410A systems starting in 2025? That is not what I'm saying at all. Currently to date for installation of existing R410A equipment, that's equipment that has already been brought here to the States, that is currently sitting in your distributors, your supply houses, everywhere across the country, you are still allowed to install R410A equipment all the way up till 2026. So any R410A equipment that is currently here, that is already here in the States, is able to be used and installed as well as sold up until 2026. What about my tools? Do I need to buy new ones with this new refrigerant? In the case of hand tools, analog manifold gauges, stuff like this, they're inherently A2L compliant because there is no spark, there is no electrical device, there's nothing in them that could potentially cause a spark, an arc, or anything along those lines. Now, the main concern for you service techs with the A2L transition is going to be your vacuum pump and your recovery machine. When it comes to NAVAC, we actually have an entire A2L line. If you want to know more about that, you can actually check it out on our website, or you can reach out to one of your local distributors. They'll be more than happy to give you an example or even a pamphlet or a brochure to show you what tools we produce that are A2L compliant. Examples of A2L compliant tools that we produce, such as our vacuum pumps, like our NRP8DI, our NRDD, and our NR7, which that's our vacuum pump, and two of our recovery machines that are A2L compliant. We wanted to make sure we could make this transition as easy and painless for you technicians out in the field as possible. It's also why we produce these videos, in order to help keep you updated on not just the equipment that we provide, but anything that we know that is currently happening in our industry. That way we can make sure you can stay ahead of the game. In fact, in regards to A2L compliant, we actually have equipment that is actually A2L, A2, and A3 compliant, such as our recovery machine, the NRDDF. The F is marked for flammable refrigerant use. We also have our A3 compatible vacuum pump, such as our MP7DPF, which is a flammable refrigerant vacuum pump. What about the A2L cylinders? I've heard they're gonna be reverse threaded. You have heard right. The cylinders that the refrigerant will actually come in is going to be a reverse threaded or left-hand thread cylinder. In order to access these cylinders, you would need an adapter that would go from a left-hand thread to a right-hand thread to use your current manifold and current service hoses. To help prevent cross-contamination and also to make it less easy to lose, because I can see service techs losing adapters over the year, we produced a hose that actually has a reverse threaded end that is easily identified by that split ring pattern on the actual coupling itself. Instead of carrying around an adapter that you're most likely going to lose and potentially cross-contaminating things by going from 22 to 410A to the A2L refrigerants, we provide you with an A2L hose if you should so choose it. Talk to your local distributor or check it out online. It's the NH5L. And then the last question, and probably the biggest one that I get, what is really changing for me as a service tech? Honestly, not a lot. If you have been performing your job the right way the entire time, so you've been following the proper processes and procedures that have been put in place, not just to make sure that you're doing your job best of your ability and the most efficient way possible, but it's also to keep you safe. You're gonna find that your day-to-day operations really do not change all that much. However, I am not telling you to throw caution to the wind. This is an insanely exciting time in our industry where we're seeing the new refrigerants come out. If you've been in this industry long enough, you've seen a few of these transitions. It's always a really cool, really interesting time whenever we start to switch to a new refrigerant. But just know that NAVAC is here, and we are prepared to help support you guys out in the field with our A2L line of tools, as well as our technical training and our support to you at any time. If you need anything, don't hesitate to head over to navacglobal.com. You can reach us there. Or again, if you want to reach out for local training at your distributor, go and talk to them and say you want to see me in person to give you an A2L presentation. This has been Jesse with NAVAC. Appreciate you.